Mark. We're delighted to be able to have this time. It's a little bit different to how we run our other virtual events, which are very presentation based, but we're going to discuss a little bit around why we wrote this book and some of the topics that we've been asked in a lot of the media interviews that we've been doing lately around the book. And one area that we keep getting asked about is why now? Why did we write this book now? You know, we've been talking about Generation Alpha for a number of years, but why do you feel like we wrote this book now?
Well, Generation Alpha are just such a critical time in their life, you know, born since 2010. So they're about to enter the teenage years. They're moving from primary school to high school. They're facing that journey towards a bit more independence in their life, which is a critical time for parents to guide them well, for educators to equip them well, for us as a society to set them up well. And we know that from the previous generation, they've just gone before. You know, we see some of the struggles that they've had around the digital, around mental health, around well-being, around just working out where they're going in life. And so I think it's a critical time for us as a society to understand this generation, to set them up well for the next important phase of their developmental years. And secondly, because COVID has changed everything. And it has transformed this generation. Now, we've all lived through COVID, but we haven't all lived through COVID in our formative years as they have. And they did learning from home, and they have seen parents work from home, and they've seen their own events and plans come to a halt, a season off sport or dance or musical recitals, you know, be halted. And that's a challenge for them. It's created some resilience in them. But the whole COVID context means that we wanted to dig a bit deeper into this generation and look at what that means for their future. And probably the third is that they are just such a global generation, as you said in your session, that to get an understanding of this massive generation in a time of a global pandemic, as they're on the point of transition, to set them up well for their future, the time was just right, in fact, important that we wrote this book. So that's how we've decided to pull it.
Yeah, and I feel like as a business and as a company, and you know, we kept getting over the last few years just incrementally more requests to talk about them, to advise organizations about them, to help them understand them. I remember going to the Kids Screen Summit in the United States and doing a session there. And everybody, I think, as you said, they're starting to reach those secondary years in the next few years. They're on that cusp. And so people are starting to sit up and take note of what's coming after Z.
Yes.
So that's definitely an area, totally, reason why we wrote the book. I know for many people, for many, you know, podcast hosts and people who are interviewing us lately, everyone's asking about generational warfare. It's always quite an interesting topic, a little bit fun, you know, each generation poking fun or, you know, casting some shade on the generations that went before. We kind of call it generational warfare. And I feel like that's almost why we exist, to sort of give some evidence-based insights as to why generations behave a certain way, why Generation Alpha are so tech savvy and how we can help them in that. I mean, what's your take on why generations have this just standard warfare and why we need to talk about how millennials are parenting compared to previous generations and things like that?
Well, the lens of the generations is a useful one to look at a changing society, to look at changing social mores and expectations, to understand the shifts that each cohort is going through and what that might mean for their future. You know, we use this generational lens to get a sense as to what the decade ahead will hold.
Yeah.
So it's got great use. And a lot of the interactions and some of that fun of having a go at another generation is normally that. It's fun, it's got some warmth to it. It's done a lot in households. That's where the whole generational thing comes from, in families. You know, the adolescent kids will say, oh, come on, dad or mom, you know, that's of your generation, you wouldn't understand, and this sort of thing, and grandchildren to grandparents, all of that. So normally it's got the sense of warmth, but it is troubling for us when it's got that nasty edge, because one cohort having a go at another cohort, one group feeling like they're in and putting down another group, is not helpful. And nor is it acceptable in any other area of society. You know, around race, it wouldn't happen. Around nationality, it ought not happen. Around gender, it doesn't happen and it shouldn't happen. And so if it comes to a sense of disparaging the other generationally, it ought not happen as well. And you know, we're pretty clear on that in the book, and trying to show difference where it can be helpful, but not to have that leveraged against another, to understand our strengths and the strengths of the other generations. And that's of course, the tone we bring. And where that helps a society, that's important. And understanding, of course, that it's ridiculous to think that all 2 billion of these people born from 2010 through to when they're all here in 2024 are the same, yeah. are a homogeneous group, of course, is absurd. They share their times and they are more global, as we've said, but the individual differences within a generation are massive. Yes. And, of course, the connections across generations are strong. And so whether someone be a baby boomer or a Gen Alpha, you know, they have a lot in common. Our humanity does bring a lot of the commonalities as well. And you know, the generational segments are a useful first step to understand cohorts or segments, a space we work a lot in as social researchers, but it's not the final difference point because there are other segmentation lenses that we might want to look at in a society to help us understand groups. And our whole approach is to understand the groups so that we can build bridges, so that we can engage, so that we can more effectively communicate, so that we can better lead. That's the whole purpose behind understanding the generational differences, to build bridges, not just to point out why one group is better than the other.
Yeah, and I know when we were thinking about the structure of the book and the contents, and we mapped out our structure early on, obviously that went through some iterations as we kept writing and got further into the process. But we start in chapter one by the chapter's called Talking About Your Generation, and laying the foundation and the context and the importance, giving a bit of a shout out to the baby boomers and the Gen Xs and even the Gen Ys who are parenting, a lot of them are parenting Gen Alpha, before we delve into let's talk about Gen Alpha specifically. But even thinking about the structure and the flow of the book and the audience, you know, we were talking, okay, who's this book for? And I guess some of the key and the most obvious audiences are parents of this next generation, grandparents hopefully as well, especially the education sector that we tend to work a lot in. A lot of research in that sector formed the foundation for this book, and we drew on a lot of that. But I guess in the research, in the focus groups, in the surveys, what a lot of parents were talking about was the challenge of parenting Generation Alpha, who are so different, and largely because of them being raised in the great screen age. And what we tried to do in the book is provide not just context around that, but also some tips and some helpful advice for parents. What would you say in terms of that? I mean, that's the question we get asked a lot. What tips? Is resistance with screens futile? What's your perspective on that?
Well, firstly, it's to understand the amazing opportunities that exist for this generation. You're making this point in your session, you know, the most materially endowed generation ever, the most formally educated generation ever, the most technologically supplied generation ever, globally connected, you know, superlatives right across the board, you know, amazing opportunities. But for parents and for educators, you know, we do this generation no service to give them untold options and no purpose and no hope and no direction. So as much as they have as a starting point in their life, we have to utilize those resources, steward them, if you like, to give direction to this generation, to set them up for a win, to give purpose, to give resource so that they can have this hope and direction for their future. And so we see with technology, you know, great benefits, but it does have those downsides. And that's why parents are often asking us, so what are your tips on it? I feel it's a bit like Charles Dickens' Tale of Two Cities, and you know, it begins by saying it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, a time of wisdom and a time of foolishness. And we hear both of those sides coming to us, you know, when we have our discussions about technology. Shorter attention spans, it's dumbing them down. They can't do maths in their head anymore. Spelling is atrocious, right? Because everything's on the digital. But at the same time, the productivity and the knowledge they have and the connectivity globally, the awareness they have is phenomenal. We saw during the lockdowns how their learning could continue on because of the digital, how they're going to be well geared up with digital literacy to cope in this digital future. So it's got great benefits as well. I liked the little practical tip we put in the book there for parents, where we gave that little DCBA framework. And we said, you know, to get some guidance around screens, maybe some parameters around it, we said D for delay and limit the use of the screens, because There's no reason for a six-year-old to have their own phone. There's no reason for an eight-year-old to be on the iPad all of the time. They're learning tools. They're tools for social connection for a season, for a little period of time, but not having, as we found in the data, 75% of their out-of-school time spent on devices. So we need to parameter that a bit, and delaying when they have their own device is going to help in that regard. And we said the C is to communicate our values. And that's true in any area in parenting. We want to make sure that the children know what our values are and they're given those guidelines within which to operate so that it sets them up well for their future. And they're not going to know what to look at or what not to look at, what's an appropriate way of communicating with people in the social media forum and what's nasty and not permitted, unless we communicate values and guide them. And then we said the B, a behavioral strategy, so that when they just have that downtime and they just want to reach for the screen, we train them to manage those urges. And we, as parents or educators, hopefully set our own examples there. And we're not doing the same. Otherwise, it's going to be hard for them to live that out. And so we can equip them with strategies as life skills so they can manage their screen use, so that they can not react in the moment when someone says something about them, so that they can not bully back if they receive that harshness. Behavioral strategies, and then the A was accountability. And we said that ultimately, the parents own the devices, the parents have the accounts that are paying the bills, and they have that responsibility, therefore, to see that that is well used. And they, of course, have the responsibility to provide a protected and supportive environment for their children. And so that does mean accountability, where we say this, we don't watch that, or we don't go to those websites, or let me just check on your social media, or even ask the questions, how's it going, so that we can, before things do get too far in the negative with their screen use, guide them and again, set them up well. So that was our DCBA framework, which we wrote together, and I think worked pretty well.
Yeah, and there's that framework. There's other frameworks in different chapters that act as practical tips and guidelines, hopefully, that can just bolster the great work that this generation of parents are doing for this next generation, for Generation Alpha. A couple of the chapters, well, the whole book really, looks at the future. We're often described as futurists and social researchers. And we definitely, I think, in the book, almost use Generation Alpha as a lens through which we can look at the future. And for this next generation, a lot of that focuses on education, what is happening today for the primary school students and the secondary school students. And even we look at, life post-school and tertiary education and vocational training and university, and also work, what work's going to look like for them. This generation we know are going to live longer. They'll work later in their life. They're going to be more mobile. Already said all of this in the presentation earlier, but what do you, I think there's a lot of tensions even for educators around what skills do we need to equip in Generation Alpha who are going to work in more machine-assisted workplaces? Is it practical skills? Is it character qualities? Is it foundational literacies? Is it competencies? Like, it's complex, and we address that. What advice would you give to educators or who are wondering what the future needs to look like for setting up this generation to thrive in this new world of work?
Yeah. Well, because they just will have so many careers and roles, the future is so uncertain with such complexity and volatility for their own futures, we would do them a disservice to just equip them with one body of knowledge for one particular pathway, because they're going to have to adapt.
Yeah.
And therefore, the better approach, rather than pick a career like used to happen, gear up early on for a career, we're better off equipping them with definitely knowledge. I mean, definitely skills, definitely numeracy and literacy and all that schools teach. That the foundations of learning are key, but learning how to learn is going to serve them well as lifelong learners for decades. And rather than just equipping them up with work-ready skills, if we can equip them up with life skills and those character qualities so that they can innovate and adapt through multiple careers, that's going to set them up better.
Yeah.
And if we can help them not just become ready as employees into the future, but even think like an entrepreneur and develop their leadership skills, that again is going to be transferable throughout multiple careers and roles. So we're all about, and we write about it much in the book, ensuring that we can develop, yes, their learning, but learning how to learn, their competencies, their character formation, their resilience, their adaptability, their creative thinking, so that they can adapt and adjust and can future-proof rather than being locked into a narrow area because they can't flex, they can't adapt, and their future sort of is limiting based on what the external environment presents.
Yeah, absolutely. And we know that school is such a foundational formative time for any generation of children, but for this generation particularly. So we hope that there's, again, lots of practical tips in the book and some words of encouragement for teachers in the education sector in there. Final sort of area to talk about is the undertone of the whole book. I know when we were conceptualizing and discussing what this book's going to look like, that we wanted to take a really positive, hopeful approach, because a lot of people that we surveyed, from parents to leaders and educators, are a little bit pessimistic about the future. There's a lot of challenges that we don't want to be naive about, and we talk about in the book for Generation Alpha, but we do take a really positive approach. And I feel like when we've been doing media interviews over the last few weeks, a lot of commentators and hosts are like, but why? Isn't it pretty doom and gloom? There's a lot of challenges for them. What would you say to that perspective that some people hold around it's not so great to be a child in the 21st century or to be a Generation Alpha?
Well, normally the people who say that are the people that are older and are reflecting on their own childhood and making a comparison.
Yeah.
And we can often, as parents, we remember back our parents saying to us, oh, when I was a kid, you know, we didn't do it like that, we did it like this. And now as parents, we're saying the same to our children. So it's just a timeless reality that each generation sort of feels that they're an improvement on the one that went before, and probably the one coming after is headed on a downward trajectory. But of course, it's not the case. And not only is that the reality, but the pendulum swings back. It might go one way and then it corrects again.
Yeah.
And the ingenuity of each new generation and society as a whole is able to adapt to the circumstances that they face. And so we look through history and we see dire times, and we see a generation step up and respond to those dire times. And this generation will be no different.
Mm.
And not only that, but they are well-resourced to respond to these new global challenges through the technology and the resilience that COVID has forged in them, the global connections that they have, the ongoing learning and wisdom that is being instilled in them. So they've got the resources to tackle these new challenges. But probably beyond all of that is that their perspective is that these are the only times that they've known. They don't have other times to compare it to. And so they're embracing their times like every generation embraces their times, with youthful enthusiasm.
Yeah.
And so when we talk to the young people, as you know, you know, there's no other time they'd be alive than the 21st century. There's no other age they'd rather be than young at this time, and no other place they'd rather live but in the countries and you know, when we survey Australians here, you know. So you know, best of times, best of place, best of age, they're loving it. And sure, there are challenges, and sure, there are uncertainties, and COVID hasn't been the fantastic start that a lot of us experienced. But it's the times they've known, and they're thriving generally. And I think what will help them is us guiding and resourcing them, and not lamenting the tough times they may have, but just equipping them and supporting them as they live through the only times that they'll ever have and that they'll ever know. And that's probably a better approach.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously that ties in really well with the subtitle of the book, which is Understanding Our Children and Helping Them Thrive. And we do want to, that's the reason we wrote the book, is to help parents and leaders and educators and anyone who takes an interest in them and the future understand them, so that we can help them to be resilient, as well as realistic about the challenges, but also optimistic about the opportunities they're going to have. So
yeah, totally.
Thanks, Mark.